Your Excellency, can you give us a little report of the current situation right now at the moment?
Current situation, you mean in Syria or in the U or at the UN?
At the UN here in the room, yes.
Well, as you know, the Human Rights Council is continuing the discussions of its agenda of the 37th session, which has started early this month. Yesterday, there was a session which was dedicated to an interactive dialogue, or let me be more specific, what should be an interactive dialogue with the so-called Commission of Inquiry on Syria. The dialogue, as we have seen it, did not indicate the presence of any serious dialogue or any interaction between the participants. What we have seen is the circulation of reports which are recycled each and every session of the Council, and political statements that continue to form a part of a media and political campaign against Syria, which has started back in 2011 when this commission has been established. And this highly politicized discussion continues. The question that we raised yesterday in the meeting, that what value added is this discussion bringing to the issue of human rights? What we are seeing is that this issue of protection, the protection of human rights, is being utilized and misused by a group of countries who are trying to manipulate this issue for political agendas in Syria. And unfortunately, we see the reports of the UN and statements by some UN officials moving in the same direction, serving the interests of this specific group of countries, which are in reality part of the war on Syria. So this is the background of the meeting that took place yesterday. And as I said, we heard politicized statement. We heard the same accusations, which are biased, which are not consistent with the mandate and the independence expected from this kind of commission continuing. That's why we expressed our dismay with this type of action that the commission is adopting. We have expressed concern about the working methods adopted by the commission, and we have serious doubts about source of information that they use to accuse come up with their accusations in the report.
Now, just as a reminder, you know, in 2011, the war in Syria began, and some say it has always been a foreign war with proxy forces fighting on behalf of foreign superpowers. What is your view on that statement?
Well, since 2011, we have been consistently saying that terrorism has been the core of this war, which has been directed against the Syrian state. Terrorism has been used as a tool by a group of countries, regional and countries outside of our region, to support terrorists and send and finance terrorism and send weapons to Syria as part of a war which was launched against the Syrian state and the Syrian government. Since the very beginning of developments in Syria, weapons were used against our police, which were dealing with some demonstrations that took part in southern parts of Syria in a peaceful manner. But since the very beginning, weapons were used by some demonstrators against our police. We had martyrs since the very beginning of those developments. And that has been the main part or main tool of this war against Syria. As we see the development since then, it confirms what we have been saying, that the main problem in Syria is terrorism. The main problem is the support that terrorism is getting from external players, regional and international, and that terrorism is being used as a tool to serve political purposes, and that continues. And this has also been confirmed recently by some political figures, whether Qatari or Saudi, who admitted that they have started to send weapons and to finance terrorism in Syria since the very beginning. For example, the ex-prime minister of Qatar has publicly admitted that they have been sending weapons to support different terrorist groups in Syria since the very beginning. That was a clear recognition and a high-level official admitting their support to terrorism.
Now, the Syria's Grand Mufti said in an interview in 2015, but I think it's still, you know, the statement stays, stop arming, enabling, and funneling the terrorists into Syria, work with the Syrian army and government to eradicate terrorism, and very quickly we will see peace. Is this your government's view as well? Or?
Well, I think this is exactly what I have been telling you, or what I have just been telling you. The main problem in Syria is terrorism. The main problem is the external sponsorship of terrorism. And the main problem is the financial and military support to this terrorism. And of course, all of this is coming through borders with neighboring countries. Once these neighboring countries make sure that they control the borders with Syria, once countries which are supporting terrorists stop their support and abide by relevant Security Council resolutions, certainly then we can say that the problem in Syria is going to be solved easily. There is no real problem between Syrians. The problem is the role of external powers which are trying to create facts on the ground which are responsible for this war that is claiming the lives of Syrians. Other than that, any issue can certainly and seriously be discussed between Syrians and agreed upon. But the precondition is to stop this external support to terrorism in Syria, in fact.
You know, also the Grand Mufti said that the devastation in Syria, the war is manufactured to safeguard the interests of Israel in the region. He said,
well, if you look at the current situation across the region, you will see that Israel is the main beneficiary from the current situation, where states in the region are being undermined in different ways, including through support of terrorism, where armies are being confronted in a way that serves the interest of Israel, as they think. And we see, on the other hand, some Israeli officials clearly speaking about continuing their occupation, their illegal occupation of the occupied Arab territories, including occupied Syrian Golan. And they are trying to benefit from the current situation to impose on the world to accept their occupation, to accept their illegal annexation of Jerusalem and the Golan, which is not going to be possible with many resolutions adopted by the Security Council, which are clearly stating that this occupation is illegal and should come to an end. But I think the Israelis are mistaken if they think that this situation could serve any purpose. The main interest in the region is to genuinely end this occupation, not trying to prolong conflicts and occupation in the region.
There was recently in the media a talk of a British diplomatic cable which was leaked to the Lebanese media outlet Al Akba. Do you know anything of this?
Yes, I read about it, and frankly I was not surprised, because this is what these countries, a group of countries led by the United States with the support of Britain, France and regional countries like Saudi Arabia, Qatar and Turkey have been trying to do in Syria all along since 2011. They have been trying to destabilize the country, to undermine the state, and are adopting some policies on the ground which are quite detrimental to the unity and integrity of the Syrian territories. When you look at the American behavior in the eastern part of the country, where you see the illegally formed so-called coalition, international coalition, which was formed outside of the international legitimacy, since it was not, it did not enjoy the consent of the Syrian government, nor it was authorized by the Security Council, are trying to utilize the pretext of ISIS to cover their illegal military activities on Syrian territories. When you look at the Turkish aggression on the northern parts of Syria, and the way they are committing crimes against Syrians in the northern part, in the city of Afrin and elsewhere, it tells you that this group of countries are in reality working to undermine the state of Syria and putting its unity and integrity, territorial integrity in danger. And this does not come with something new. In fact, we have seen similar reports leaked by WikiLeaks since 2006, where American diplomats were suggesting to their headquarters in Washington similar schemes to undermine the Syrian state and government. So it is a continuation of policies which have been addressed against Syria for a long time.
In the cable, there's also mentioned organization, Small American Group. Is this a group that you know who they are, a small American group?
Well, what we see, in fact, is a small group of countries which have allied together to work against Syria. And I just mentioned them, United States, Britain, France, and their regional allies like the Turkish, Qatari, and Saudi regimes, who have been working consistently on the ground in support of all those armed groups that are working and fighting the government. And we see the same group of countries working in international organizations, as we see them in this chamber, to launch a political and diplomatic war on Syria, which is in harmony with what they are doing against Syria on the ground. So this is the most dangerous group that is working against Syria, this group of countries, in fact.
Change the subject for a minute. Is there anything that your government does to protect minorities like Christians in the country, in the conflict, during this conflict?
Well, in fact, my government is doing its best to protect all Syrian citizens, regardless of their religious denomination or the whatever social group they belong to. We believe that it is the duty of the Syrian state and the Syrian government to protect all its citizens. And this is the essence of our war against terrorism, because, as I said, the main threat to our citizens is the daily terrorism that we see everywhere. This is the reason why we have the military operations in Eastern Ghouta, for instance. As you know, Eastern Ghouta has been used as an area to launch indiscriminate shelling against civilians and civilian neighborhoods in Damascus. And this shelling does not differentiate between Syrians according to their religious or ethnic belongings or social belongings. It targets all Syrians, and this is what the army is doing, trying to protect all our citizens, and certainly including Christians, of course. And certainly we are very much interested, or we care about maintaining this rich social fabric in Syria with all components of the Syrian society. We see this as a form of strength to Syria rather than anything else. So certainly the government is doing its best to protect all its citizens, including Christians, of course.
Personal question. You know, this goes on now for 7 years. So how do you personally cope with this daily stress, with, you know, the accusations, all the things that you go through? You know, that is probably a lot of pressure. You are from Syria, so they're talking about your home country. How do you feel about this?
Well, I think I feel like any other Syrian who have been under pressure since 2011, under different forms of pressure. Unfortunately, you see here in the United Nations, countries who are claiming that they care about the human rights of Syrians, about the daily living conditions of Syrians. But at the same time, it is ironic that these same countries are the countries which are imposing illegal unilateral sanctions or coercive measures against Syrians. which are violating their human rights, which are negatively or have negative repercussions on their living conditions, daily living conditions. So I consider my work here as part of or one aspect of the war which we are facing. Today on the ground, we are facing war of terrorism. We are facing war of aggression by some regional and international countries. And here we are facing another type of war against Syria, which is the diplomatic and political war. And I think this gives me another impetus to do my best to face this war. We understand what are the real intentions behind all these pretexts that we hear by some countries. We know that they are misusing the issues of human rights or humanity to achieve political agenda against my country. And this is how I deal with it and cope with it.
Do you think there's a real chance that there will be peace soon in Syria? Do you have hope?
I am sure once, as we have been saying, this external factor which has been negatively affecting the situation, aggravating the situation on the ground, is eliminated, I am sure it won't be difficult for Syrians to agree. Syrians love their countries. There are some Syrians who have been brainwashed for sure, who have been misled, but we are sure that those who really love their country, once we eliminate this external factor, it won't be difficult to come up together and agree on our country. And this is why we always say, in the context of the political process, that it is only the Syrians who should decide the future of their countries. And these Syrians should demonstrate that seriously.
The peace talks that take place here in Geneva, is this something that you think will be progress towards peace? Is this really doing something?
Well, we hope so. I mean, we have been participating in each and every political track that could help saving the lives of Syrians. We as a government never hesitated in responding to any invitation to participate in any political talks between Syrians, because we believe that the political solution should be based on intra-Syrian dialogue, which should give the Syrians the right, the sole right, to determine the future of the country. And it is with that understanding we are participating in the talks in Geneva. But the problem there is, first of all, we see heavy external involvement influencing the talks, whether through a group of people which are being brought to the talks and which are representing the interest of the countries that supports them rather than representing the aspirations of Syrians, and due also to the fact that some countries are trying to pressure and influence the UN itself in the context of these talks. But we are continuing with these talks. We, as I said, we never hesitate to explore any avenue that could help saving the lives of Syrians.
So as Christians or Catholics, you know, we pray, of course, that there will be peace soon for all people in Syria, because they are the victims of all that. And I think everyone would agree that this is a real humanitarian crisis in a way, aside from the fact that it's a war, you know, all these people that die. So we wish you really, for your country and for yourself, peace.
Thank you very much. And I agree with you that there is a great deal of human suffering because of this war in Syria. We are doing our best as a government to respond to the needs of our people as much as we can. We have been so far, and this is something many people don't know, that we have been so far contributing more than 70% of all the humanitarian assistance which has been distributed in Syria. We are cooperating with the UN, with ICRC and other international organizations to facilitate delivering humanitarian aid to all Syrians everywhere, regardless of their where they are in Syria. But again, unfortunately, even this humanitarian file, we see it as a tool which is being politicized here and there to serve political agendas rather than serve the people and help the people on the ground. But we are continuing. We believe this is our duty as a government towards our citizens, and we are continuing with our efforts.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Thank you very much.
Thank you.